my people to my teaching. I will open my mouth in a parable.
I will utter dark sayings from old.
Things that we have heard and known.
That our ancestors have told us.
We will not hide them from our children.
We will tell the coming generation the glorious deeds of God.
We will tell of God's might.
And the wonders that God has done.
God established a decree in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel. That the next generation might know them, the children yet unborn.
That they might rise up and tell them to their children.
So that they should set their hope in God.
And not forget God's works, but keep God's commandments.
Thank you. stingy, greet one another with signs of love and grace. Let her rip. Send them out to further their childhood. May they have all the wondrous joys of childhood and adulthood that await, in the sure knowledge that you go with them, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all the days of their lives. Amen.
I have a song first.
Oh, we got a song.
Thank you. Okay, now let's pray. Almighty and merciful God, it is only by your gift that your faithful people offer you true and laudable service. Grant that we may run without stumbling to obtain your heavenly promises through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Okay, please join me for a moment of silent prayer, and then I'll pray on behalf of all of us. God, we thank you this day as we thank you every day for your presence with us, for calling us into being, and for calling us to be this prayerful community. We pray that your Spirit be among us this day and every day. May you watch over us and guide us. We know that you hear our prayers and that you know how to answer our prayers in ways beyond our understanding. Yet we give voice to you every day with our prayers, as you have ordained for us to do. We know that a broken and contrite heart you will not despise. We know that our prayers arise to you like incense and is a pleasing sacrifice. We pray this day as we pray every day for Donald, our president, for Paul, our governor, Susan and Angus, our senators, Shelley, our member of Congress, our representatives in Augusta, members of our town council, and local government. May all those who serve a public trust do so with wisdom and justice tempered with mercy. We pray for those, especially those mentioned today, who are sick in mind, body, or spirit, and those who care for them. We pray for our sister congregations in Gray, and especially for those congregations around the world who are enduring persecution and suffering for the gospel's sake. May our hearts be full of gratitude and rejoicing for this gift of life, for the gift of family and friends, the gift of being able to gather and worship in a free country, the gift of living in a beautiful place. And we give thanks always for those who rejoice with us, but upon another shore, and in a greater light, that multitude which no one can number, whose hope was in the Word made flesh, and with whom in you, O Lord, we forevermore are one. And we close our prayer time by praying as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power. response now or after the reading?
That was the call.
Oh, okay.
Our scripture lesson today is to remind us that we cannot hide from God. And if we do try, we run into a lot more trouble. So today we're reading from Jonah, the first chapter, verses 1 to 11. One day long ago, God's word came to Jonah. I made the sun. Up on your feet and on your way to the big city of Nineveh. Preach them there in a bad way, and I can't ignore it any longer. But Jonah got up and went the other direction to Tarshish, running away from God. He went down to the port of Joppa and found a ship headed for Tarshish. He paid the fare, went on board, and joining those to Tarshish as far away from God as he could get. But God sent a huge storm at sea, the waves towering. The sailors were terrified. They called out in desperation to their gods. They threw everything they were carrying overboard to lighten the ship. Meanwhile, Jonah had gone down to the hold of the ship to take a nap. He was sound asleep. The captain came to him and said, "What's this, sleeping? Get up, pray to your God. Maybe your God will save us in trouble and rescue us." Then the sailors said to one another, "Let's get to the bottom of this. Let's draw straws to identify the culprit on this ship who's responsible for this disaster." So they drew straws. Jonah got the short straw. Then they grilled him. "Confess, what is this disaster? What is your work? Where do you come from? What country? What family?" And he told them, "I am a Hebrew. I worship God, the God of heaven who made the sea and land." At that, the men were frightened, really frightened, and said, "What on earth have you done?" As Jonah talked, the sailors realized he was running away from God. And they said to him, "What are we going to do with you to get rid of this storm?" By this time, the sea was wild and totally out of control. And then we move into Acts, the 27th chapter, the 33rd. 44th verse. For someone else who was on the sea. With dawn about to break, Paul called everyone together and proposed breakfast. "This is the 14th day we've gone without food. None of us has felt like eating. But I urge you to eat something now. You'll need strength for the rescue ahead. You're going to come out of this without even a scratch." And he broke bread, gave thanks to God, passed it around, and they all ate heartily. 276 of us, all told. With the meal finished and everyone full, the ship was further lightened by dumping the grain overboard. At daybreak, no one recognized the land, but then they did notice a bay with a nice beach, and they decided to try to row the ship up on the beach. They cut the anchors, loosed the tiller, raised the sail, and ran before the wind toward the beach. But we didn't make it. Still far from shore, we hit a reef, and the ship began to break up. The soldiers decided to kill the prisoners so no one would escape by swimming. But the centurion, determined to save Paul, stopped them. He gave orders for anyone who could swim to dive in and go for it, and for the rest to grab a plank. Everyone made it to shore safely.
Show.
coming to church. Thank you for helping out with the Holly Fair or for just showing up. Thank you. Thank you especially for your pledges and support throughout the year. And of course, you are especially welcome if you are new amongst us this morning. And if you are, I'm not going to embarrass you by asking you to stand up, but please give someone a hearty hello on your way out. I have just a few announcements this morning. We will not meet for Bible study this week because it's Thanksgiving Day. We will meet the following week on the 30th. And then the following week, December 7th, we will have a very special meeting at Jean Humphrey's house. So if you need a little extra inducements to come to Bible study, come to Jean's house, we'll have extra good hospitality, and we've been having a lot of fun at Bible study, so do join us at 9:30 on Thursday mornings. Likewise, we will not meet this coming Friday for Christian yoga, otherwise called Bend, Stretch, and Breathe, a ministry of movement, but we will meet at 5:30 in the vestry back there, as usual, on Friday, December 1st, and for the Fridays in Advent thereafter. Do join us. Anyone can play. You don't need a yoga mat. You don't need to look good in yoga togs. All you have to do is show up. And just to help you with your holiday planning, remember that Christmas Eve will be on Sunday this year, the 24th, so we will have two services that day at 10 a.m. and 7 p.m., and we will not have a service on Christmas Day. And now a word about communications. Communication is always important. We're about to run some ads in print media into the notes and then another monthly newspaper that appears in stores and stuff around the area. We continue to post sermons and make announcements of church activities on Facebook and other electronic media. This is a bit of work, but we think it's worth doing. After all, our posts on Facebook brought Peter Sawyer back to us for a few months, and that was certainly worthwhile for all concerned. It is a difficult age for communications. The multiplication of means of communication, I suspect, is not actually making communication any easier on the whole. Maybe in some total it is, but if you're in one of those pockets where communication is not getting easier, well, it's a very frustrating time to try to communicate with people. I will confess to being rather clumsy at using this thing. I'm not good at picking up messages. I'm not good at setting notifications so it beeps when I want it to beep, and it doesn't beep when I don't want it to beep. I'm still working at it. I'm clumsy at picking up messages off that and off of the church telephone as well. I might just confess to being plain clumsy with regards to electronics in general. And I suspect I'm not alone. So, these new media of communication provide us all with ample opportunity to practice Christian kindness and forgiveness and patience. Amen. Final note on communication is that the best communication is still in present time without any devices other than eyes and ears and mouth. There is no substitute for just being present with one another, and the best way to get people to come to church is to invite your friends by word of mouth. Tell them that we have some wonderful people in this congregation and a couple of bad apples. And we have a fairly decent preacher who gives decent sermons and a couple of bad apples. So please come join us on a Sunday morning. Now for our lessons today. I did plan on this coincidence of our two Bible readings this morning. We have been focusing on the travels of St. Paul all summer, and this week we hear about how he survived a shipwreck in the Mediterranean off the coast of Malta. And not only did he survive it himself, but acted in such manner as to save the lives of others. So then I thought, what Old Testament story would go with this? And I found the perfect Old Testament story, of course, the story of Jonah, who survived, indeed actually averted a shipwreck, by confessing his sin to the sailors, being thrown into the ocean to appease the angry God of Israel, getting swallowed by a whale, getting disgorged onto shore, and thereby finally following God's orders for him to prophesy to the people of Nineveh. It's one of the most popular and beloved stories in the Bible. It easily lends itself to being acted out in Sunday school and by high school youth groups. Thus, we hear about two water-born prophets, Jonah and Paul, both of whom were unwilling at first, but finally fulfilled their duty. It is ever thus. We hear our last of Paul next week when he finally gets to Rome, and the story ends rather maddeningly, inconclusively. But that's Paul next week. Now, it is just a coincidence, I chose these readings a while ago, it is just a coincidence that Herman Melville published Moby Dick this time of year in 1851. It was little noted at the time, selling about 3,000 copies in the author's lifetime, but it was rediscovered by literary critics in the early 20th century, and now it is a rite of passage for all college English majors and American studies majors. If anything is the Bible of those departments, it is Moby Dick. So in keeping with today's theme of sea voyages and shipwrecks, I can't resist reading to you the justly famous first paragraph of the 635-page whopper of a book. It begins, "Call me Ishmael." Some years ago, never mind how long precisely, having little or no money in my purse and nothing in particular to interest me on shore, I thought I would sail about a little and see the watery part of the world. It is a way I have of driving off the spleen and regulating the circulation. Whenever I find myself growing grim about the mouth, whenever it is a damp, drizzly November in my soul, whenever I find myself involuntarily pausing before coffin warehouses, and bringing up the rear of every funeral I meet, and especially whenever my glands get such an upper hand of me that it requires a strong moral principle to prevent me from deliberately stepping into the street and methodically knocking people's hats off, then I account it high time to get to sea as soon as I can. This is my substitute for pistol and ball. So, with a philosophical flourish, Cato threw himself upon his sword. I quietly take to the ship. Of course, we know how this story ends, this ultimate fish story. The ship goes down with all hands, except for Ishmael, who has to survive to tell the tale. And it's unclear what happens to the whale. Moby Dick is a very important, one of the first examples of a type of fiction in which the reader is put on alert from the beginning that the narrator is not entirely to be believed. This is a disturbing development, especially for biblically literate people like us, because we believe, don't we? We believe the people who wrote the Bible. Yes, we believe that they were inspired by the Holy Spirit. We trust St. Luke, who wrote about Paul. We trust St. Paul himself. And we trust the writers of the Gospels. We trust these books as being historically and literally true. that the authors meant what they said, and that what they said really happened. In the case of Jesus, he wandered about, told stories, healed the sick, was executed, lay in the grave for at least a while, and rose from the dead. His eternal spirit inspired his disciples some 40 days later, inspired St. Paul a few years later, and many others, and inspires us today. This we believe. And all this we get from the Gospels and from the letters of Paul and others. The story of Jonah, however, is something else. Almost no one these days thinks it really happened. It is one of the books of the Bible that almost no one on earth thinks is literally true. It's just a story, a charming, delightful story that gives us some insight into our human condition. There is a bit of a Jonah in each of us. Perhaps that's why we find it so charming. We all have had those days when God was calling us to do something, or we felt called to do something, and we didn't do it. Because we were afraid, because we got confused, because the message wasn't entirely clear, or we couldn't make up our minds, or whatever. Negative consequences followed to the Jonah of the story, and they followed us in our own lives. At times, being human is seldom easy. Finding our way in the world, making adult decisions, well, it isn't easy. It just isn't. According to the story, Jonah spent 3 days in the belly of a whale. Most of us have spent much longer than that, experiencing the consequences of a bad decision before we emerge from the darkness and into the light. Thankfully, the God whom we fled, the destiny we dread, has a way of working us out of the darkness and into the light. God's grace has a way of finding us and setting us right. So these two stories of shipwreck are both excellent stories for this time of year. We are always getting shipwrecked, and God is always tossing us planks and helping us get to shore. We are not inside the belly of a whale, but we are in the dark time of year, a time to be inside and look inside and await the return of the light, which we will celebrate at Christmas. Amen. God's word in response to the hearing of beautiful hymns. Let us hear what's sitting lightly upon your heart. Sing to us.
I don't know if we want to sing to you, but thank you for all the prayers. My surgery went very well, and I appreciate your prayers and thoughts.
Even though they make my hair turn gray, I am joyful and blessed to work with these young people. And I want to thank Joe and Hannah and Scott and Tommy and our newest member, Lexi, for doing their best. They are awesome to work with.
Growing. Two babies were born this week. Great nieces, and everything's good. One in Colorado, one in Portland. But it's the next generation. And then my daughter's due this on the 27th, actually. She thinks she's going to go early.
Where is your daughter on Wednesday?
Lily is my daughter. She's my best friend, and she lives in New Hampshire, but she wants Maine babies, so she has. Her baby's in Maine. She likes her doctor in Maine.
Good. I like that. All right. Is that a hand over here? Yes. Okay.
I am happy to report that thanks to my cousin Barry and a backhoe, the giant limb made it to the ground without injuring person or property.
Quite an operation. I just watched. Oh, Jane.
My blessing was working yesterday in the kitchen at the fair. My little kitchen angels, they know who they are. And it made for a wonderful, fun day for us. And the blessing I had today was that Kathy Skillins walked in with my cell phone. That we've all in this church, thank you so much. Nancy's looked at my car, I think, 10 times. And anyways, so I am blessed. Thank you.
Thank you. your work in this church, in this community, and around the world. In the redeeming name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.